Before we begin, I wanted to quickly talk about edubirdie.com. If you're in school or college and are struggling with your academic papers, be sure to check them out. They are a professional essay writing service and can help you out in a big way. The 2017 draft was a goldmine filled with talent, and it might go down as one of the strongest draft classes we've seen to date. We watched Donovan Mitchell and Jason Tatum show off their already near elite scoring abilities, Lonzo Ball showed off his very good all-around game despite not shooting it well, Dennis Smith Jr. and John Collins both showed off their supreme athleticism, Lauri Markkanen has the ability to become a prototypical stretch big in today's NBA, and many others showed potential to be very good players down the line as well. All the names I just mentioned were players that were selected in the lottery, and they have all received appropriate hype surrounding their promising futures that they have ahead of them. Whether it be from the national media, local media, or just conversations between fans on Twitter, basically every player selected in the lottery of that draft has received acknowledgement as a bright young player when the conversation comes up. Except one. The 10th pick in that draft belonged to the Portland Trail Blazers after they traded with the Kings, and with it, they selected Zach Collins. This brings us to the topic of today's video, where I will be discussing Zach Collins' career to this point, why he has seemingly been forgotten about by most, and why I believe he is still going to develop into a very good big man in the NBA. Before I start though, make sure to subscribe to the channel as all support is very much appreciated. Now with that being said, let's begin. Zach Collins wasn't always someone that flew under the radar in his basketball career. In fact, coming out of high school, he was a McDonald's All-American coming out of Nevada. He got offers from quite a few big-name schools, Arizona being the biggest program on his list, but ultimately he committed to play for Gonzaga, which has been a very good program for years now, but they don't garner much coverage on a national scale because they don't play in one of the power conferences. The West Coast Conference typically only has like one or two other good teams in the conference besides Gonzaga every year, and Gonzaga always wins the conference title. Collins only played one season in college at Gonzaga, and oh man, was it a successful one. His Gonzaga team only lost one game during the regular season, they won their conference tournament, and they advanced all the way to the national championship game before they ultimately lost to North Carolina. Collins was a key contributor to the team, but the crazy thing about his season was that he came off the bench during every game and still made such a big impact. Gonzaga was an experienced group filled with upperclassmen, so as a freshman, Collins bought into his role and made the most of it, which is a great attitude to have. Collins was already having a solid year before the postseason began, but his play during March Madness is what elevated him as a prospect into getting serious lottery buzz. He dominated in the post, showed off range out to the three-point line, where he shot an impressive 47.6%, albeit on unlimited attempts. And most importantly, he showed off a phenomenal ability to protect the rim on defense. His shot blocking was huge for Gonzaga, and he even made the all-tournament team afterward because of his elevated production. He declared for the draft after only one season, becoming a one-and-done, and while his game was still a bit raw and inconsistent, his March Madness tournament run certainly showed the potential that he has in his game and how it would translate to the next level. He wound up getting drafted 10th overall by the Portland Trail Blazers, as I mentioned earlier, and ever since then, he has flown way under the radar. Because of this, allow me to update you on how his career is going so far and why I am still a huge believer in his development for the future. First off, the reason that the Blazers traded up for him was because their big man depth was very lacking, especially moving forward. Yusuf Nurkic, their starting center, had just signed an extension keeping him under contract for 5 more years, but after him there were a lot of question marks. Ed Davis was beginning to become a productive big off the bench, capable of dominating the glass and playing into his role offensively well, but he was only under contract for 1 more year at the time, and the team probably knew that they weren't going to sign him long term after that contract expired. Davis played out the rest of the year last season, and as expected, he was not re-signed in Portland. Instead, he signed with the Brooklyn Nets this past summer. After Nurkic and Davis, the only other threat to minutes at the position was Myers Leonard, who was a lottery pick all the way back in 2012, and now going into his seventh season is looking like a dud. He has yet to carve out any sort of consistent role on the team because, quite frankly, he just isn't that good of a player. He's a capable three-point shooter as a stretch big, but is not nearly enough of a threat to put him on the court for too long because of his struggles in basically every other aspect of the game. So with that information being known, the Blazers took Collins in the draft with confidence that he could step into that role that Leonard could never earn and Davis would soon be leaving behind. But first, he had a lot of learning to do. To start the season, he wasn't even in the rotation. In the first 23 games of the year, he only played in 7 of them, and he only got a handful of minutes in the games that he did play in. The most he played in that span was 10 minutes in a game, but he only got 1 minute of garbage time in a few of the other games. This isn't abnormal though, because the Blazers were a very good team looking to make the playoffs, so they were of course going to play the experienced guys that they know will produce for them early on over an unproven rookie. As the season went on, though, he earned the trust of his coaches and teammates, and slowly but surely began to play more and more minutes every game. After those first original 23 games, where he only played in 7 of them, he got playing time in every game from that point on. Also, it wasn't just garbage time minutes like he had previously been getting either, but he was actually a part of the rotation. As I say all of this, I should clarify that he wasn't really playing spectacularly by any means, and it's not like he was the sixth man of the team now, playing big minutes and putting up big numbers, but this progression was at least an improvement. From that point on, he played about 17 minutes per game through the end of the season, which is still not a ton, but just the fact that he broke into the rotation of a playoff team as a 20-year-old one-and-done rookie is a big accomplishment in and of itself. As I mentioned earlier, defense was his calling card while at Gonzaga, and it continued to be the case in the NBA. That area is the biggest reason he took Myers Leonard's spot in the rotation, and his production on that end of the floor was very good when you take a deeper look into what he did in limited minutes. He excels at protecting the rim, and while he may not necessarily block every shot attempt that comes his way in the paint, he certainly does alter a ton of them. He only blocked 1.1 shots per game per 36 minutes, which is pretty average by normal standards. However, his ability to contest shooters and make them miss was tremendous. When he contested a player's shot at the rim, he made his opponents shoot 13.1% worse from the field, which is up there with the best of the best bigs in terms of rim protection. Joel Embiid made players shoot 12.1% worse at the rim, Rudy Gobert made players shoot 9.9% worse at the rim, and Anthony Davis made players shoot 10.4% worse at the rim, just for a reference to how insane Collins' production is in that regard. Also, Collins did play a lot fewer minutes per game, and did contest a lot fewer shots than those other guys, so by no means is he in their realm as a rim protector yet, but it's hard to deny that Collins is definitely off to a promising start in his career as a defender. This brings us to this season, where I foresee a huge breakout year for him. As I mentioned earlier, Ed Davis is now in Brooklyn, and Myers Leonard is behind him on the depth chart, so he gets all of the backup center minutes now, and in the first few games of the year, he looks much improved in every aspect. Against the Lakers in their first game of the season, he recorded a whopping 6 blocks off the bench, which is absurd. He moves his feet so well for a big man, and his instincts to go get in the right position have been on full display. Offensively, he's also looked much improved. He doesn't force his shots and has been knocking down the ones that he has been getting. He shot 3-for-4 in his first game, and in his second game so far, he shot 4-of-5, including shooting 2-for-3 from deep. Overall, his efficiency plus his defensive excellence makes him someone that everyone should stop sleeping on and pay more attention to. He may not have the flashiest game in the world like a lot of the other players that were selected in the lottery of his draft class, but Collins is just so solid in so many other different ways. He may not overtake Nurkic as the starting center this year, even though I wouldn't count it out entirely, but within the next few years, he will be an anchor for the Blazers for years to come. And with that being said, that's all I have for you today. Make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel for more videos coming soon. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next video.